Saying, this is your first time here tonight. I'm Pastor Josh. No, Pastor's not my first name. First name's Josh. And lately, over the past few weeks, we're talking about the Holy Spirit. Somebody say Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Somebody say Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hey man, is anyone like digging this series right now?
Yeah.
Like, I gotta be real with you guys, man. I'm just getting what God is teaching me and giving it back to y'all, because it's completely like revolutionizing and rocking my world, man. So before we go any further, I'm going to pray, then we're going to dig on into the word tonight. So Father, we thank you so much for your word. God, we thank you that your word is real. It's living. God, it's powerful. God, it's not just ink on a page, but God, it's the real deal. So tonight, Holy Spirit, we welcome you to come and change our lives. God, tonight, we don't want to leave this place the same. God, tonight we want to leave different. Tonight we want to leave having encountered you on so much more of a deeper level. So with both hands lifted up in the air for me, I just want you to say, Holy Spirit, tonight I open up to you. Have your way in my life. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen, amen. So we are now on part 5 of this series. It seems like it's going on forever. You know, we said that our key verse or our theme verse for this series is 2 Corinthians 13, verse 14. It says this, "The amazing grace of the Master Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, and the intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." See, we can look at this verse and we find out that the role that the Holy Spirit is supposed to take in your life, in my life, is intimate friend. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing, man? God, the third person of the Godhead wants to be your BFF, your ride together, die together. You know what I'm saying? He's like, yo, when you go to the bathroom, I want to go to the bathroom. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's like that kind of intimate best friend. You know, you girls are weird. You guys like travel in packs everywhere you go. I'm like, really? The bathroom? It's just, I've never gotten used to it. Like, not one time. You know? So that's the role the Holy Spirit is supposed to take in our lives. You know, in week 2, man, how many of you guys remember the painting that we did in week 2? How many of you guys do not remember? Well, you know, we read this verse in Ephesians 2:10. It says this, "For we are God's masterpiece." Somebody say masterpiece.
Masterpiece.
Somebody say masterpiece.
Masterpiece.
He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. You know, I said a few weeks ago, for years I looked at this verse, man, and I thought it was talking about, you know, the day that we were made. You know, about how the Bible says that God formed us together in our mother's womb, about how he knit together our DNA. And I was on the plane coming back from Washington, and God spoke to me, and he said, "Son, that's not what I'm talking about." He said, that's not what I'm talking about. And so I caught a key part of this verse, the part where it says he created us anew in Christ Jesus. Is that right here? God is not talking about the day you were born. He's talking about the day that you were born again. So the day that you were born again, you see, you got to understand is that, let me explain it to you. See, on our beautiful picture here, before we had this thing and it was all filled up just with sin and junk and a mess, man. I mean, there was fear, there was confusion, there was hatred, there was unforgiveness, there was bitterness. I mean, you name it, it was there. And that was to represent what our lives looked like before the Holy Spirit came, right? Before God came and before we got born again. And so what we did is we took some red paint and we covered up words like fear, and we covered up words like hate, and we covered up words like forgiveness, because the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all of our sins. And so then we ripped off the page and we had this blank masterpiece. And we said that the day that we got saved, man, God came, he took Jesus' blood that was shed for you and for me, and he covered up our junk. And he covered up our mess. And you know, he didn't only cover up our mess, but he cleansed it. And he ripped it off, and he gave us a brand new start. Man, he gave us, man, a brand new place in life. And said, no longer was I to be recognized by my past, by God. See, no longer would God look at me and say, oh, you know, he struggles with confusion. oh man, he has a big hatred problem. And all this other stuff from my past. But now all he saw was the blood of Jesus, because it was the blood of Jesus that cleansed my life. Are you following me tonight? And so tonight before us, we have a blank masterpiece. A brand new masterpiece. Is that me and you are masterpieces in the making. Hear that tonight? We are masterpieces in the making. See, I can look at this masterpiece and it's obvious that it's not done yet, right? Right? This would be a pretty boring masterpiece, right? Is it ever weird to you guys? So people like buy just like the most weirdest, abstract, boring pictures in the world. You know what I'm saying? It can be like a white picture, like, I'll pay $2 million for that. You know, like their fancy voices. You know, but I'm glad though that the Holy Spirit is not done with us. No, but if I can be honest with you guys, you know, even after salvation, I mean, even after Jesus came and he cleansed my life, is that I've had plenty of days where I feel like I'm the farthest thing from my masterpiece. See, I don't know about you, but I've had plenty of days where I feel like, man, God, I blew it again, God. I messed up again, God. Man, Holy Spirit, I know this grieves your heart, but I did it again. Man, God, I'm supposed to be your masterpiece, God. And I feel like I'm the farthest thing away from that. See, I don't know about you, but I know about me. Because if I can be honest with you, Pastor Sam, you can go ahead and come on up for me. You know, Pastor Sam is going to play the role of the Holy Spirit tonight, at least in this example. And so Pastor Sam is a Holy Spirit painting on my life. You know, he's beginning to paint the masterpiece. Man, is he shaping and molding my life? And I'm like, yeah, Holy Ghost, this is sweet, man. This is just bananas. That's like my new word, bananas. You know, and he's painting. And I'm like, dude, sick. That's cool. That's cool. Oh. Holy Spirit, I don't know. Whoa, Holy Spirit, hold on. Whoa, Holy Spirit. I don't know if I want you to paint there yet. Can you paint over here for me? Hey, paint over there for me. Down, right here. Oh, yeah. Blessing, baby, come on. Oh, you using me in my gifts, in my talents. Oh, I have a purpose. Holy Spirit, didn't we just talk about this? Listen. This area right here, we can save that for like last, man, all right? You know, how about this? You know, I read some verses in the Bible that it said that you would prosper me wherever I go. I really like those ones. Can you paint that on my life? Oh, guys, this is going to be great. I mean, bananas! He's painting, okay? Yeah, I'm digging it. Yo, huh? Come here. You sit down. Thanks, Pastor Sam. Sam's good. You know, but go, Pastor Sam. Can you push the easel forward? Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. There you go. I read that a little late. That's all right. See, what I found out in my life, I don't know about you, but I'm talking about me tonight, is that as the Holy Spirit begins to mold me and to make me into the image of Jesus, and he begins to paint on my life, is that he addresses issues that I don't really want addressed. You know, is that the Holy Spirit is really good at crossing in to the off-limit zones. You know, is he's painting in my life, you know, and here he is, man, it's looking good, you know, with this invisible paint. And he starts to write love. And then he gets to this point in my life, you know, where he tells me, son, if you really want my love, then you gotta let go of your bitterness and your unforgiveness. And I say, whoa, Holy Spirit, you need to calm down. Holy Spirit, you don't know what that person did to me. Holy Spirit, that person wounded me so deep. I don't know if I can forgive them. I mean, they hurt me. You don't know what they did to me when I was a kid. So Holy Spirit, you can just skip over that for right now. And so the Holy Spirit says, we can talk about that a little later. And comes over here, begins to paint. And probably with like the biggest smile on his face, you know, whistling or whatever. Then he gets in this area of impurity in my life. I go, what? Holy Spirit! Excuse me. Can I have a say-so in this? You know, I know that I probably shouldn't lust. But God, she looks so good. I mean, Jesus, you took extra time on her. You know what I'm saying, y'all? You know, I'm talking about my fiance over there. What's up, baby? And so I go, whoa, Holy Spirit. I'm not sure if I'm ready to give up this lust problem I have yet. I know it's not good, and I know that it grieves you, it causes you intense, deep pain, but Holy Spirit, I'm just not sure. We can go through the list. Forgiveness, bitterness. I mean, your sexual orientation. I'm trying to think of some more. How about this? Jealousy and gossip. You can go through the list, and the Holy Spirit is, hey, we need to address this over here. Whoa! Calm down. See, what I found out in my life is that I fight for the right of the brush. Is that in so many areas, I fought for the right of the brush. You see, and for some reason, I have forgotten about what it used to be like before He came. You know, when my life was ruled by confusion, when my life was ruled by fear, when it was ruled by hatred, when it was just ruled by all this sin and this junk and this mess, and what it brought me, and then He comes and He cleanses me and He makes me new, and He's wanting to address certain things in my life. But because they're all I've known, I'm so reluctant to let go. See, tonight, I don't know about you, but it's that I fight for the right to do things my way sometimes. You know, I fight for the right of my own selfish and evil desires. You know, at times I fight for the right to become my own image maker again. My own image maker. You know, if I can be honest with you guys, when this happens and I begin to take the brush from the Holy Spirit and I begin to paint my own life and I continue in my unforgiveness and I continue in my hatred, I mean, I continue in the things that the blood of Jesus was shed for to set me free from, all of a sudden I get really distant from God. Really distant from God. You see, it reminds me of Adam and Eve in the garden. I was like, here's Adam and Eve, man, perfect environment, and they sin. And the Bible says that they saw their nakedness and that they were ashamed. That they were ashamed. And so they went and they heard God walking in the cool of the garden, so they ran and they hid. They heard God coming and said, oh man, we gotta hide. God's coming. God's coming. He's gonna find out what I did. So they ran and they hid. I don't think he'll see me down here. I've lost some weight. This pool might block me. That's a pole, not a pool. And they ran and they hid. See, and I found in my own life that when I have control of the I make some mistakes. And so I go and I run and I hide too. Is that? And then all of a sudden, you know, I hear verses like Ephesians 2:10. Can you put that up there for me again, Mooney? And verses like Ephesians 2:10. It says, "For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus." And I think, man, if I'm brand new, if I'm a brand new creation, then why do I still struggle with, you can fill in the blank. Why do I still struggle with this? Why do I still struggle with that? I thought I was brand new. You know, and then the thoughts really hit you. Thoughts like, man, am I really even saved? How many of you have ever had that thought before? I mean, I know I've had that thought so many times. I mean, am I really even saved right now? You know, does God even still love me? Is that then I get disheartened and I begin to back off my relationship with God because I just can't seem to get it right. I just can't seem to get it right, man. See, my cry was, God, I hate grieving you, but I don't know how to stop. God, I don't know how to stop this cycle that I'm in. God, I don't know how to quit this sin. God, this thing has me bound. Jesus, I want to be free. I really, really, I do. But God, it seems like I just can't stop. See, tonight, if you've had those thoughts, if you've been stuck in a cycle, then you're not alone. See, a man named Paul, who wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, he said this in Romans chapter 7. He said this, I don't really understand myself for what I want to do, or for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. And I don't do what I want, or I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyways. But if I do what I don't want to do, I am really not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does that. I've discovered this principle of life that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart. But there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Thank God, the answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Man, guys, you want to talk about getting real? You want to talk about getting vulnerable? And here's Paul, man. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, and he opens up a segment of his life that I'm sure was very private to you and to me. And so listen, I've been where you're at before. See, I was in the place where I wanted to do what was right, but I couldn't. And guess what? When I wanted to do what was right, I couldn't. And when I didn't want to do what was wrong, I just messed it all up, man. I just kept on messing it all up. Is that I was stuck in this cycle. See, and I love how he says that what a miserable person am I? See, when you're stuck in that cycle, man, when you're stuck in that place of sin and it's happening over and over and over again, and you're like, God, my life's supposed to be a masterpiece. God, how do I get free? And you're stuck in this cycle over and over and over again. It's just like, will somebody let me out? Man, will somebody set me free? It's just absolutely miserable. But tonight, I have some amazing news for you. Do you guys want to hear amazing news? Yeah. I mean, do you want to hear absolutely amazing news? Yeah. You see, this guy named Paul, he figured out the answer to your problem and to my problem. So we wouldn't have to. That's good news. Look what it says in Romans 7, verse 25. It says this. It says, Romans 7, 25. It says, thank God the answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Woo! That just like went so over your guys' head, but that's all right, because I'm going to explain it. Thank God the answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. So how is the answer in Jesus? See, the Bible says that when I got saved, I became one with Jesus. Listen to me tonight. And that means because I'm one with Jesus, I'm able to partake in everything that he's done, in everything that he is. You're like, dude, what are you talking about being one with Jesus? You know, or being in Jesus? Really quick, look at Colossians 3:3. It says, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Somebody say, in God. In God. Go to 1 Peter 5:14. It says this, peace be with you, all of you. Peace be with all of you who are in Christ, right? And so I was starting to thinking, man, like, God, what does it mean to be in you? Like, God, what does that really even mean? And, you know, I can't think of a better way to show you guys what it means to be in something or to be one with something than to make some brownies. How many of you guys like brownies? Say, Pastor Sam, can you get me a bottle of water wherever you are? Man, guys, I got to be honest with you. Man, I have like a brownie addiction. I could eat like a nice warm brownie over some like cold vanilla ice cream. You know what I'm saying? Oh, every night. So right here we have our mix, right? Mix. So I'm going to bust open this mix. Hey, Sam, can you grab me a Dr. Pepper too? So I'm going to grab my mix. Grab my mix here. Oh, hell, that went like everywhere. All right, so I'm taking my mix, man, and I'm pouring it in the bowl. Woo, you know me. All right, let me take this. Let me grab my instructions here. All right, so instructions. Blend, first preheat oven. We don't have an oven in here, but that's all right. It says, blend cake mix, water, oil, and eggs. Okay, so right here, we have our mix, right? Right? And right here, so what I'm going to do is really quick, I'm going to add some water. Really quick. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I got some water in there, man. I got some water in there. All right, next, because we don't have oil, why not use Dr. Pepper? Right? All right, someone take me some DP. What? Right? And so far, I have my mix going, right? And then now it's time for the last step. I got to add me some eggs, baby. You know what I'm saying? I got to add me some eggs. And so, here we go. You ready for this?
Yeah.
Ready for this? I need some cheering. You know what I mean? Thank you, man. So here I go. You guys ready for this?
Yeah.
Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
Ah! All right, there's one egg. I'm supposed to add 3 eggs in here. All right, so here we go. Boom, 2. Get out of there, egg yolk. I'm coming, man. I'm coming, bro. Ah. 3 eggs. You know, there's a shell in there. It's all right.
Yeah.
We could tell them it's like a nut or something when they taste something crunchy. You know what I'm saying? All right, and so what happens next? Okay. So right now, listen. Right now, it's pretty obvious that the eggs are separate from the batter, right?
Right.
Because they haven't been mixed together yet. But when I take this, I smell the Dr. Pepper. All right? So when I take this and I start mixing together the eggs, right? And I start making these one. Come on, man. Guys, this right here is why you work out for when you have to make brownies. Okay. Now, if I were to come around, I'm going to show this guy's in the front row. Now, can you see any egg in there at all? Any egg in there? I'm going to come over here. Sorry, live streamers. Get down really low. Can you guys see any egg in here?
That's nasty.
That's nasty, bro. What are you talking about? All right, I'm going to come to you guys. Can you see any egg in here at all?
No.
Can you guys see any egg in here at all? Huh? I'm just kidding. All right, so you're telling me, all right. You're telling me that when I took the egg and I added it to the brownie mix, that because they become one, that the egg's identity by itself disappeared. It did. I can't find any egg in here. I mean, I can look really hard, but there's no egg in here. See, because listen to this, is that when you add the egg and you mix in it and it becomes one, is that the egg becomes part of the brownie mix. It becomes part of the brownie mix. Yeah, oh, right. Listen, and so what happens here? You see, Jesus is the brownie mix because he tastes good. All right? So taste and see that the Lord is good. That to me is talking about brownies. All right? What happens? See, and you and me are the egg. Okay? When I get put in Jesus, guess what? I get to partake of everything that's in the brownie mix. Of everything that's in the brownie mix is that there's healing in the brownie mix. You see, there's peace. Brownie mix, I'm talking about Jesus here, obviously, guys. Come on. I'm talking about Jesus, not the little brownie mix. Even though there is peace in the brownie mix, All right, you guys just haven't had that revelation yet. But are you guys seeing what I'm saying here?
Yes.
Okay, now catch this. Catch this for me. I want you to go to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. It says this. It says, we have died this sin once and for all. As a dead man passes away from this life, so how could we live under sin's rule a moment longer? Listen, or have you forgotten that all of us who were immersed in the union, dropped into the brownie mix, dropped into the brownie mix with Jesus, the anointed one, were immersed into union with his death? Next verse for me. See, could it be any clearer that our former identity is now and forever deprived of its power? For you were co-crucified. You were co-crucified with him to dismantle the stronghold of sin within us so that we could not continue to live one moment longer submitted to its power. Listen to me really quickly. The Bible says in Romans 6:17 that before you were saved, is that you were a slave to sin. That word slave there is the Greek word doulos, and that is one of the most despicable words in the Bible for servants. You see, someone who was a doulos or someone who was a slave is that they had no rights. See, they didn't have the right to say, oh, hey, I'm going to go out tonight. You guys have fun. Because they were owned by someone else. You see, me and you, we were owned by sin. You see, sin said jump and we had to say how high. Sin said run and we had to say how fast. Is that it's almost like I was a puppet. And when sin said do this and the passions in my body rose up, then I just went and did it. Why? Because I didn't have any power to stop it. See, but the Bible says, listen to me. The Bible says that when I got saved, when I got dropped into the brownie mix, that guess who I became one with? I became one with Jesus, right? Now this is about to get really, really good here. I became Jesus, that means I got to partake of everything that Jesus did. So when I became one with Jesus, you know what Jesus did? He died. He died. Listen, not only did he die, but he rose again. And when he rose again, the Bible says that he defeated the power of sin and death. Okay, let me put this in over with you guys. The Bible says this, that literally Jesus, he was in hell, that he took the devil by the collar of the by the devil's collar and he dragged him around hell. Jesus dragged the devil around hell, showing every demon that the devil was defeated, showing sin that he was about to lose its power over God's children. And then at the very end, he took the devil, he threw him on the ground, and he took his foot and he put it on his head. Now in the Old Testament, when a king would go into a city and conquer it, he would grab the king and he would place him in front of all the people that were still alive. And he would throw him down on the ground and he would put his foot on his head, declaring, I am Lord over your king now. So when Jesus took the devil and dragged him around hell in front of every demon, what was he saying? I am Lord over your king now. Come on, y'all. So listen, not only, okay, I'm going to say this, is that the moment I became alive in Christ, the moment I became dead to sin. Have you guys ever seen a dead, where's Pastor Sam for me? Pastor Sam, come on up for me, man. Come up for me, bro. I need you to lay here for me like a dead man. Okay, now Pastor Sam is dead. You're so dramatic, man. Are you twitching on me? You're supposed to be dead. What are you doing? All right, so here's Pastor Sam. All right, and let's just say, man, that I wanted to try to get a reaction out of Pastor Sam. How hard do you think that would be? That would be pretty hard. I could say, hey, you smell bad. Dude, you do smell bad. I'm kidding. You know, you're dead. Get down. Shut up. All right, and so, I could even resort to kicking Pastor Sam to have him respond to me. Or I could say, hey, dude, come on. Hey, come on, man. Come on. I could even pour water on Pastor Sam. You know? You're supposed to be dead. You're supposed to be dead. Right? And guess what? No matter what I do, is Pastor Sam going to respond? Why? Because he's dead. Thanks, dude. I'll let you get me in one of my sermons, in one of your sermons sometimes. You see, guys, listen to your Bibles. This is not going to be on the screen. From here on out, man, it's free for all in this sermon thing. We're going to figure out where we're going. But go to Romans chapter 6 for me. Oh, come on. Romans chapter 6 for me. Listen to this. Listen to this right here. It says, for when you died with Christ, in verse 7, with Christ we were set free from the power of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know that we will also live with him. Now skip down to verse 11 for me. Listen to this. This is the verse I was trying to find. It says, so you also consider yourselves to be dead to the power of sin. You see, the reason why most Christians struggle is because they're not fully dead yet. The reason why most Christians struggle is because sin comes along and you're like, man, I still kind of like that. You know, is it really that big of a deal to go and sleep with her? You know, is it really that big of a deal to go and touch her in places I shouldn't touch her? Is it really that big of a deal to go and look at stuff I know I shouldn't be looking at or to say things that I shouldn't be saying? See, you're not dead yet. You haven't considered yourself dead, so you still respond. Until you die, sin will rule your life. Until you consider yourself dead. Now, this is the part that's so cool. This is the part that I was trying to figure out in my notes how to say earlier. Is that when you got saved, the Bible says that the power of sin was broken from your life and that God sent the Holy Spirit to come and live in you. The Bible says you are the temple of the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit lives on the inside of you. And I love it is that Jesus didn't only break the power of sin in your life. He sent you someone who has power. So he sent you someone who has power. Go to Romans chapter 8 for me. Ah, guys, this is about to get good, I'm telling you. Romans chapter 8 for me. Listen to this. This is right after Paul said, thank God the answer is in Jesus Christ. In Romans 8, 2. This is what he says. He says, and because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin and death. The power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin and death. Now, listen to me, okay? The Bible says that Jesus was in the grave. Jesus was in the grave. And then the Bible says this. It says that the same Spirit who raised Christ from the dead lives in you and me. So in the grave, what did Jesus do? He conquered sin and death. He conquered sin and death. You know what that tells me? If the Spirit rose him up from the grave, is that the Holy Spirit had a part in conquering sin and death. Guess where he lives at now? He lives in me. He lives in you. You see, you got to understand is that on the inside of you, you have the best sin-conquering agent in the world. See, you don't need a 12-step program. Man, you don't need to go to, I'm not saying counseling is bad, but listen, as long as I ignore the Holy Spirit's power in my life, I'm never going to see freedom. See, but when I let his power kill my flesh, come on somebody, that's when freedom happens. See, listen to this. This is the last verse and we're almost done, man, because I'm preaching so long tonight. Well, let's go with verse 12. It says, therefore, dear brothers and sisters, you have no obligation to do what your sinful nature urges you to do. Why do you have no obligation? Because you've been set free. Verse 13, for if you live by its dictates, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. For if by the power of the Holy Spirit you put to death the deeds of the sinful nature, you will live. See, tonight you have to understand that freedom is not ever being tempted. Freedom is the right to say no. Freedom is that I have the ability and I have the right that when my sin just rises up and the devil comes and tries to tempt me, I can say, dude, bug off. Sorry, I don't know where that came from. Bug off. I thought they say that now. That's so lit. Okay, never mind. But you can say, dude, go away in the name of Jesus. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Why? Because he has no place in my life. Is that he doesn't control me anymore. My sin doesn't rule me anymore. But the power of the Spirit is living on the inside of me, man. But until I am able to surrender my sin, my chance, the Holy Spirit grabs the brush and he's about to paint over some unforgiveness in my life, and something inside me wants to rise up and say, whoa, Holy Ghost. But instead of saying, whoa, Holy Ghost, I say, all right, Daddy, tie me down tight to the altar. Daddy, tie me down tight to the altar. God, I want it all gone. God, kill every single part of my flesh, because I want to look like you. I want to look like you. Daddy, tie me down tight. When he addresses that impurity issue, Daddy, tie me down tight. Because God, I am your sacrifice. No, in fact, I lied to you. More scripture. So with all this dying stuff in mind tonight, I want you to hear a scripture that you've probably heard 1,000 times, but hear it tonight with fresh ears for the first time. Romans 12, verse 1. It says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God. I plead with you to give your bodies to God, because all he has done for you, let them be a living and a holy sacrifice. See, are you dead yet? Are you dead yet? Or is there still a part of you that's holding on? Is there still a part of you that's twitching, man? See, tonight the key to walking in freedom is surrender to the Holy Spirit. That's what the Lord told me earlier today. I was in my office trying to figure this message out. I mean, I was having the hardest time of seeing what to put in and what not to put in. And the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and said, tonight it's about surrender. Tonight it's about surrender. Tonight there are things that need to be given up. There are parts of lives that need to be crucified. There are areas of your flesh that need to die. See, there are areas of your life that God tonight is wanting you to die to. And there's an anointing and there's a power here tonight for it to happen. But you've got to take a hold of it. Or will you continue in sin? You continue. So, see, can I tell you guys the biggest problem with living a lifestyle of sin is the thing that bugs me the most about it? Is that it robs me from intimacy with God. See, holiness is not a scary word. You know what the word holy means? It means to be set apart. It means to be set apart, man. That's all it really means. It's not, you don't have to say some special prayer to be holy or whatever. See, God tonight is wanting to set you apart to keep you all for himself. Amen. So with every head bowed and eye closed for me. Tonight, if you're in this place and you say, man, Pastor Josh, there are some things in my life that I need to die to. There are some areas in my life that I need to surrender to. On the count of three, I want you to lift both hands up in the air. One, two, three. Thank you. Thank you, 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 thank you. Come on, who else is it? There are some areas in your life that the Holy Spirit has been bugging you about, saying you need to get rid of this or you need to get rid of that. Why? So that you can become more intimate with me, child. Come on, if that's you, I want you to lift your hands nice and high in there. In fact, can everyone just stand up for me really quick? Everyone just stand up for me really quick. And with my eyes closed still. Come on, if that's you in this place and you say, I need to consider myself dead tonight, I want those hands lifted high in the air. Those hands lifted high in the air. Come on, you're not shy about this. You're not ashamed of this. You say, tonight's my night of freedom. Tonight's my night of freedom. I want you to repeat after me. I want you to say, Jesus, tonight, you see my hands. Tonight, I choose to surrender. And I want you to name what it is. Right now, name what it is, just between you and Him. You can whisper it out loud. Name what it is. Name what you're surrendering. Just say, sin. Come on, say, sin. Right now, I renounce your power and your dominion in my life. I declare that I am united, that I am one with Jesus. And tonight, I turn my back on you, sin, forever. I am done with you. I'm breaking up with you. Me and you are done forever. So Jesus, thank you for forgiving me of everything that's not of you. Thank you for deeper intimacy with you. And Jesus, tonight I thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit helping me put to death my sinful deeds. In the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, now every head still closed. Every eye still closed. Every head still bowed for me. Man, I can't leave this place tonight without giving you a chance to accept Jesus as the Lord of your life. Because this is where it really happens. That if you have never accepted Jesus as the Lord of your life, here tonight I'm telling you that God isn't mad at you. Man, God's mad about you. See, tonight, man, God is just so crazy in love with you. In fact, the Bible says that God is so in love with you that He came and He sent His one and only Son to die for you. Because you and me, when we were born, we had sin in our lives. It is that we had this disease running through our veins called sin, and it was sending us to hell. But Jesus said, I'll come and take the punishment for your sin. And He died for us. And He said this, if anyone believes in me, if anyone confesses with their mouth that I'm Lord and believes in their heart that I was raised from the dead, they will be saved. They will come into a right relationship with me. So tonight, if that's you in this place, you want to enter into a right relationship with God, on the count of three, I want you to raise your hands. 1, 2, 3. Is there anybody in here tonight? Anybody in here tonight? Thank you, I see your hand. Thank you, I see your hand. Is there anyone else? Thank you, I see your hand. Come on, tonight you said, man, I want to come into a relationship with God. That's what this thing is about. It's not about rules and regulations. It's about a relationship. 10 more seconds. All right, if everyone could pray this prayer with me really quick. This is the most important thing that we've done all night. Say, Jesus, I believe that you're the Son of God. I believe that you came and died for my sins. So right now, I ask for forgiveness of all my sins. I need your blood to cleanse my life. I confess you as Lord before all of heaven and earth. From this day on, my life is committed to you. In the name of Jesus Christ.